Hello, good afternoon and welcome. I hope you had a good lunch. The presentation I'm going to make is a revised version from the one I did last 2 years ago. This time focus more on the second half of Tolkien's journey. To do a quick recap, for those who don't know, in 1911, there's a bit of feedback. In 1911, Tolkien did a journey to Switzerland with his aunt Jane and a party of other people. And we have no idea exactly how long it took, but it must have taken a substantial amount of time in August and September time, of maybe those full 2 months, because that's the only way of fitting all the places and the very traveling in that period. The first half was, he did it on the Bernese, they traveled in the Bernese Oberland. Oops. So, to give you an idea about the locations, they arrived in Salzburg, and they traveled by train to Zurich, then went down to Bern and Thun, and then spent some time in the Bernese Oberland, in that area there, which has been identified quite persuasively, the area of Lauterbrunnen, as being the origin of the ribbon, the famous Rivendell setting and the Rivendell drawing in The Hobbit. In my talk last time, they didn't travel just there, they went all throughout all that area in the Bernese Oberland, and then they crossed a certain pass called the Grimsel Pass here, and they went down in the Valais, which is another canton in Switzerland, which is half German, half French, and spent a substantial amount of their journey traveling down, up and down all these valleys to end up in a place called Arola down here, before coming back there and catching the train at Sion, which took them back to the UK via Lausanne and Valorme and that way. I didn't have that much time to spend on the second half of the journey last time, because there was so much to look at and to show and to see about the Bernese Oberland section. So I decided to spend all of this talk on that area, and especially with having revisited various places and various locations in there that have additional information. And I will also correct
some mistakes I made last time.
So nobody's perfect. And it probably won't be the last version of this, because there's other corrections and other additions. But at the end, it's going to turn into a monstrous, enormous thing.
Danger.
Without much further ado, so I need to move on to slide 53. That's okay. Excuse me. Just trying to do several things at once. That's good. You did see the Rivendell that way. You can see all the slides without the commentaries. Just engage your photographic memory, which we all have. Yes, we're about there. Okay. Yes. So the Grimsel Pass. So the valley is an enormous, is quite a long canton, and the name is called because it's the whole Rhone River that flows that way. So from this part here, this part is the Bern canton and the Grimsel Pass, which doubtlessly is the inspiration of many high passes in the Hobbit and the Lord of the Rings, but not necessarily the Carabras one. And then they went down that way. And they went to the sort of bombs, and then I show all the details. So I've retraced a lot of those steps, but not being a good walker, which I leave that to other people like Thomas Kirch here and a couple of other colleagues who are around who give additional commentaries. I did it by car, and I got myself a little GoPro camera, and I stuck it behind my rear view mirror, so that it enabled me to, blue tack is wonderful. It's much better than what GoPro could provide, and they took less space. And I just could record what the landscape I was driving in. So let's go down the valley. So this is first the first part is known as the Orbegans or the Val de Conche. I'm going to present this quite relatively rapidly here, but we're going to go back there later on because it's a far more significant landscape than I thought of when I first went down there. Up the Rhone Valley, Tolkien says, we later crossed the Grimsel Pass down to the dusty highway beside the Rhone on which horse diligences still plied, but not for us. When I first visited that place in 2013 in June, there was still some, so this is the Rhone Valley. The descent towards Brig seems to take forever. It's a succession of nearly flat, wide alluvial areas narrowing towards a narrow edge, and a quick descent leading to the next flat zone, and so on. It's a geological feature which is quite familiar to people who know geography and geology, because it's caused by the gradual melting and shrinking of glaciers, in this case the Rhone Glacier, which is now greatly reduced and quickly disappearing. So the Rhone Valley, it might have inspired the drawing from Roverandom. It looks very much like it, especially the left-hand side. This is a landscape down the upper Rhone Valley. Look at this. Those of you who know Tolkien drawings, does this look like something vaguely familiar? Hands up, somebody who might have an idea. Yes?
Nargothrond?
Yes, exactly. Nargothrond. But I didn't notice that at the time because I was driving down and the colours were... It didn't look like that to me at that time. It's only when I revisited my films that I realised, wow, this is it. So I had to make a special journey again, which I did this year. So other views. So looking down. Notice the peculiar rounded slopes here. That's something you can see on this. And it really reproduces what we can see. The first time I saw that, I thought, oh, it's a very stylized view of mountains in a bit of a Japanese style. I'd never thought that it would be representational. Tolkien drew what he had seen, and he reproduced it, and he reproduced it a great many times. Notice here, and part of another drawing. Which drawing is that?
It's
Glaurung finds Sigsturin, and of course you have those funny hills there. And now we know where they come from because they don't quite seem to fit the landscape as is. They seem to have been added there, but they have to be there because it's now Nargothrond, and that's how Tolkien sees it. Another view. What's interesting is that when you go in the area, the Rhone is very swift, is a torrent at this level, and it's very swift with rocks showing, big rocks and boulders showing on the bed. So, no comment, I think. If we have some time at the end of the show, I'll show you a few minutes of driving down in that area, and you may have an interesting surprise at the end. So, other views of Nargothrond. I can't see this place without thinking I'm in Nargothrond. I mean, driving in there. Well, you know, you want to know what this place looks like. You want to be in a story. This is the place to go.
Norport.
Here's the King's Gate. And of course, the one we all know. So they finally arrived in a place called Brig. In Brig, they spent a night before going up again into the mountains, going north again to the Aletsch Glacier. So Brig is the comments that you see in letters is we reach Brig on foot, a mere memory of noise. Then a network of tram that screeched on their rails would seem at least 20 hours of the day. Well, obviously, there are no trams in Brig. It's way too small. However, Brig is the main access to the Simplon Tunnel, the Simplon Tunnel. And the trains that kept Tolkien away during the night is basically overnight trains, passenger trains, and freight trains at 20 hours. So it's somebody misread what Tolkien said and took trains to be trams. So correct your texts. Another view of Brig. I've added on this version all the compass rows so that you can have an idea of the location. This is the map of the Alledge Glacier area. They spent some time there. Christina and Wayne, in their concordance, in their sort of say that he went to Bellalp. In actual fact, it cannot be Bellalp because they walked up to the glacier. Whereas if you see here, Bellalp is over high, the glacier is way down below. But a place where they could have been is Blatton there. And the problem is that in 1911, the glacier went as far down as here. So now it's melted and it's up there. And in the place of the tongue of the glacier is an enormous dam called the Gibbon Dam. And it would just have been just about a mile up the road to get to the Alledge Glacier. Tolkien refers to those in two letters. In the early 60s, letter 2032 to Joyce Reeve, and another one to Michael Tolkien, which was not sent in the late 60s. So this, the early one is 1961, and the other one is 1968. So it's about 50-odd years after that particular journey, and his memory would have gone pretty vague. We have two accounts of that Swiss journey, the two letters which I've just mentioned, and an account, an abbreviated account of that, in an excellent book by Andrew Morton called Tolkien's Gedling. Who has got this book at home? If you haven't, you should. There's a follow-up volume called Tolkien's Bag End, and it's another must volume to have. All sort of biographical details. And what's interesting is that another person on that journey was called Colin Brooke Smith, and he held a diary, and other people held a diary, and he gives far more details than Tolkien gives in his letters, and the details he gives can be sometimes at a substantial variant from the information that is in letters. So this document, at the end of Tolkien's Gedling, is far more accurate. And I'm still mining it for information, and there's further talks that could be in the piping for that, coming from that. Because Tolkien attributed some incidents, he attributes an incident in the Alledge. "We journeyed on foot with a heavy pack through much of Switzerland and over many high passes. It was approaching the Alledge that were nearly destroyed by boulders loosened in the sun rolling down a snow slope. An enormous rock, in fact, passed between me and the next in front." In actual fact, Colin Brooke Smith says this did not take place in the Alledge area at all, but it took place in the southern half of the trip, which is on the other side of the valley, in the southern section of the road. So I tend to trust much more what Colin Brooke Smith says in the text here, rather than the memories of Tolkien, which may have confused the two. There are several reasons why he could have confused those. One is that once they crossed the Alps way to the south of the Rhone Valley, he went in a sort of French-speaking area. And he's not half as good at French as he is at a great many other languages. And he admits so. Whereas he could play all sorts of pranks in mock obscure Germanic dialects that didn't actually exist to intimidate the maids or whatever, wherever they went, and a bit of showing off in front of the other people in the party. Whereas there, he felt a bit inferior, and other people spoke better French than he did on that particular trip. And a great many of the incidents, and his memory, he, in his mind, he may have mixed things up. And so the information that he gives in actual fact is not accurate in letters, and it's much more accurate in that section of the diary. Tolkien is human. So he makes mistakes when he recollects memories of things, don't we all? So let's take that into account and be kind. So they spent some time in that part of the world, in that area. And so this is the Elish Glacier, relevant areas, Belalp, which is here. And I say it can't possibly be there. It's much more likely to have been here because the glacier would have been starting round about there. So there's not that much left. So in the 1930s, this was what it was like. The water episode that Tolkien refers to is here. The practice of the beaver game had always fascinated me. A wonderful place for the game, plenty of water at that altitude coming down in rills, abundant damming material in loose stones, heather, grass and mud. We soon had a beautiful little pond containing, I guess, 200 gallons, and the pangs of hunger smote us, and one of the hobbits of the party, he's still alive, well, he was in the 60s, shouted lunch and wrecked the dam with his alpenstock. The water soared down the hillside, and we then observed that we had dammed a rill that ran down to feed the tanks and butts behind the inn. At that moment, an old dame trotted out with a bucket to fetch some water and was greeted by a mass of foaming water. She dropped the bucket and fled down, calling all the saints. We lay more doggo than men on the moss hacks for some time, and eventually won our way round to present time. However, it didn't take place there, it took place on the other side. So this is from Belalp, the glacier. And he said, we climbed and we spent some night in a chalet inn under a roof and in beds, or rather under it, the bed being a shapeless bag under which you snuggle. Did the party actually stay in Belalp, which overlooks the glacier, or in Blatton, situated below? Notice the chapel and the size of it. And it's specifically a chapel. So this is Blatton. The last time I showed that section of the show, I showed a different Blatton because I didn't know there were two within a few miles of each other in that part of the world. Because the other one is known as Blatton am Löschental, which is further to the west. But this is Blatton, which is now differentiated Blatton by Natters. And so it's a different landscape. So notice the tip of the tongue of the Elish Glacier is just visible here, because before it would have been much. So no, that's the dam. This is where the glacier would have been at the time. Today the glacier is much receded, and a large reservoir is visible instead. I remember going to confession in Latin. Well, in a chapel there's nobody to give you confession. However, in a church, there is. This is the church at Blatton. And this is the inside. So, the glacier reduced, several views. Visitors to the Elish Glacier around the time of the Swiss journey. Note, these are not the people of the party. The clothes they're wearing were traditional mountaineering equipment at the time. However, this is the travelling party. This is a photo in Tolkien's Gedling. Tolkien is the one with the white scarf. Jane Neve is a tall one here. The tall lady in the middle with a large hat. Notice their tracker staff, which could be inspiration for wizard staff. Note, count how many people are on this picture. On the left here, you have the guide, but there's a person who takes a photo. Who has counted them? 15, yes? So include the photographer and remove the guide and Jane Neve, and you end up with how many?
4.
Which is a lucky number. So another photo, a more select one. Jane Neve is probably the one there. This is the one there. And Tolkien is the one sat down. So we're now going to travel south of the Rhone. We could see quite persuasively in the previous show when I showed the Bernese Oberland that this part could be quite an accurate representation of the mountains in the Misty Mountains with all the snows and the glaciers, and the Caradhraskill and Dilfenwidol, which are a close match for the Eiger, the Munk, and the Jungfrau. On this side of the mountain, you're going to find different Alps. These are much drier. There's still there's a lot of white around, but as we move towards that part of it, it gets very much drier, and you may get different mountains. 5 minutes left already?
No, well, 10. You've got another 10 minutes left, so.
I've got another hour.
Sorry, idiot. Sorry, pardon me. My fault.
Thank you. So, it's an expanded view of the previous map. I'll show you the itinerary and then we'll look at it. So, they start going up here. So, Brig is just here. You're down the Rhone Valley, up Visp, Sheldon, and then you get to a place called Saint-Niklaus. Notice how up there is a place called Zermatt. However, Colin Brooksmith, and of course up from Zermatt you have the Matterhorn. However, Colin Brooksmith never mentions Zermatt. So if Tolkien has seen the Matterhorn, it certainly cannot have been from Zermatt. Because instead they went up the mountain down here, down towards Ruben here, and then down again, down into here. And then up in this direction, Grimens, and up there, and across here, and down there, Evolen, Leoder, and up towards. Oh, I'm sorry, I'm getting mixed up with that. That's a problem when I see it from the side. So down there, across here, down there, Valdemar. Where am I trying to go? Yes, and Avolar is about there. So that's the part of the journey. And this is where a great many of the episodes Tolkien refers to as having happened in the Aleph area would have actually taken place, and where there are a great many interesting sites to look at. So, and Tolkien is honest. After referring to the Aleph area, Tolkien says, after this we went on into the valley, and my memories are less clear. Do I remember our arrival bedraggled one evening in Zermatt and the lorgnette stairs of the French bourgeois dams? If he didn't go to Zermatt, he probably confused locations with somewhere else. And in Zermatt, in those days, there were very few French people because it's a German-speaking area. And this is pre-First World War. And so they would have gone to the equivalent of resorts on the French side, which is the one that we're going to see, which is Zinal and other places, Grimens and so on and so forth. And there you could have had French dams tutting down their lorgnettes at bedraggled people walking about. We're going to explore, I'm going to take you through the sort of that particular trip down here and then across and across, up and down mountains and valleys. This is the map, well, I basically showed you what this map says. So Saint-Niklaus, what is the architecture? You go up Saint-Niklaus. A substantial part of the road they took in actual fact is part of a well-known tour around the Matterhorn area, which takes about 7 days for climbers and trekkers. So they followed it for quite a substantial amount of the time, and then moved slightly out of it a few times. But then, of course, they didn't complete the circle. They did about half the journey. This is the actual tour, as is actually well known. There's a competition these days for how fast people can make it. That's the Noritron track between Saint-Niklaus and Gruben. Now you go down the valley and to the Gruben. I've tried to find photos of the time as much as possible. This would have been the view they would have seen. Gruben is in the Turtmantal, which is a little valley nestled quite high up. And it's a sort of quite a heavenly little place, as close to Shangri-La as you can think of it. The cows are the local family, local variety. and the parties would have met many hurdles on this section of journey like this. Googling cattle herders. In those days, gypsies were used as herders for cattle in the summer. So Googling today, the Valley, Tourmental. These are maps taken from the Baedeker of the day. This is a copy of Baedeker dating 1909, which would presumably have been the very self-same Baedeker that people that they would have been using on their journey. It's available on the internet. It's reasonably cheap. I had a copy last year. I lost it. I bought another one. It arrived today. So we arrived at our college. And it was the one that was a lost and found object on newsletter 3. So there you are. If you want to peruse it, it's really, really interesting. Tolkien would have spent endless hours looking at the maps, and he may have been inspired by in his map making by the maps found in here. So recommended sort of a purchase. This is the map of the Upper Tourmental. So Gruben is here, and then down, and they went down up. They went across four clatter paths down there, and then they went up to Grimmens, and then across that way. So this, yes, this is various sort of mountains from that side, and this is the Zina Waton and so on. So these are local maps, touring maps. So they would have gone down from the four clatter pass down here, oops, down and across to get towards the Grimmens. I'm putting here the drawing of Rivendell looking west. I don't have a photo of the valley where we're in, which is known as the Val d'Anivier. However, if you look towards down the valley, which is a bit counterintuitive for us because we're not used to that sort of geography, as you look down the valley, it narrows and it gets very tight because it's been opened by the rushing torrent of the river flowing down. So Rivendell looking west, you can't see what's west of Rivendell because they can't go down to Rivendell straight that way. They've got to come from across the mountain and down into it to get there. And this looks, the Val d'Anivier looking in that direction looks exactly like that. So it's one of the tributaries of the Rhone. The tight cut is made by the river produced by glacial beltwater. Behind us, the valley is much wider because it's in the location of Vanished Glacial Lake. So that's the other view of that. And now they would have gone that way and towards Grimmens and up there. Now, of course, Switzerland is full of dams and reservoirs, which wouldn't have been in existence in Tolkien's time. So we can't see what Tolkien saw unless we use photos of the time, because it's a vanished past. So this is Grimmens at the time. Notice the bollards, and bollards like this are quite common to prevent people falling off. And they're a bit similar to some of to what I found. I found that sort of echoes of that. Is it an influence or not? I don't know. But certainly, Tolkien drew some inspiration from what he saw in the local landscapes. This Grimmens at the time in the early 1900s, in the late 1800s, not very different, same time. Today, not much has changed, it's a very well preserved place, unlike Zermatt. I went to see Zermatt for myself. It's a tourist trap. Who has been to Zermatt here? Hands up those of you who have been. It's not such a pretty place.
No, it isn't.
And of course the Matterhorn is above your head, but a lot of the time it's a terrible tourist traps, and it's aimed at making you cough as much of your money as possible and as quickly as possible, like any traps like that. Mm-hmm. At the time of the journey, the church has been rebuilt. Now, this is a photo of the time before the dam was built. So Tolkien would have seen this as they went up the road, up the side, and they would have gone across and then down the other side. Cattle in the Val de Moirie. So the cows are fighting. In that part of the world, they have cows contests. It's not the bulls that fight, it's the cows. It's a particular variety of cows. And whether Tolkien was influenced for the finding the kind of ara or not, I have no idea, but it's a So this is the following, the next map, the trekker's map. So they went up a mountain, down here, towards Evolen, and then across to Lyrda, and so you see the next leg where we're going. Now we're now in the Val d'Eran, we cross, we're in the next valley, looking south. What I found really interesting as I was driving, I found that the mountain up there reminded me incredibly of the Three Herne in The Lord of the Rings. And you can see it in the distance, you know, Helm's Deep and the Three Herne in the distance. They sort of that very sort of similar three prongs of a mountain. That's from, that's how you view it. It's really impressive. So the close of view, Helm's Deep, showing the Three Herne in the distance. This is Leodair, which is referred to in the text. And then going towards Arola, which is the where they spent sometimes, they spent probably a week or something. We have no idea how long it took. So there's a beta come up. And we now move, it's the other way around, so we go this sort of way, and we arrive here. And this is the trekker's map from Leodair to Arola, extending beyond to show the trek to the Cabane Bertol. At one point, they went on a trip, on a walking trip, up to the Cabane Bertol, which is here. And it could be from that vantage point that they would have seen the Matterhorn. I'll show you in a moment. The travel from Leodair to Arola at the time of Tolkien's visit, not the most probably the widely traveled place in the world. It's very much a non-place even today. It's sort of a, you wonder how well would people go. It's a sort of, but it's tourists love it. Come from Arola, the Mont Colomb. Christina and Wayne in their chronology refer to Mont Colomb and say they would have scaled there, but it's highly improbable that it doesn't actually match the Arola at the time of the party. The Blue Lake, which may have been one of those places where they made dams, like this, practice of the beaver game. So did it happen in the Alechera in Arola? I suspect strongly it's in this area. Rocks and scree up towards Mont Colomb and the Cabane Bertol. The summer of that year had melted away much snow and stones and boulders were exposed that, I suppose, were normally covered. The heat of the day continued the melting and we were alarmed to see many of them starting to roll down the slope at gathering speed. Anything from the size of oranges to large footfalls and a few much larger. They were whizzing across our path and plunging into the ravine, heart-pounding, ladies and gentlemen. That's the quotation. They started slowly, and they usually held a straight line of descent, but the path was rough, and one had also to keep an eye on one's feet. I remember the member of the party just in front of me, an elderly schoolmistress, gave a sudden squeak and jumped forward as a large lump of rock shot between us, about a foot at most before my unmanly knees. And that's much more likely that it would have taken place in that location because around Blaton, around Belalp, you don't have rock falls of this type because it's not the same type of rock. And this is a much drier part of the world. So for me, the inspiration, this is not so much the Erech Nimrise that we begin to look at here, but that's the Fell Dwarf. The Arola Glacier and Mont Colomb. Track from Arola to the Cabane Bertol. In all likelihood, this is the place to which Tolkien refers to. We climbed with guides up to a high hut of the Alpine Club, roped, or I should have fallen into a snow crevice. And I remember, and I remember the dazzling whiteness of the tumbled snow desert between us and the black horn of, guess what, the Matterhorn some miles away. So as you will see, we have a stereo photo. If you cross your eyes, you should be able to see it in stereo. It does work. If you don't have access to a stereograph, you can do that. View up to the Cabane Bertol. It's a very tough and steep climb. And the Cabane Bertol is somewhere up there. It's in that sort of direction. The Cabane Bertol, look at that. The climb towards it may have inspired the stairs of Kirithungol. Certainly the steep climb towards it involves climbing up ladders, or it did at that time. Now they've got a metallic staircase. And the cabin has been rebuilt. I didn't go there. I don't not believe that. So this is the drawing that Tolkien did of Kirithungol. I've removed the text. And it gives a sort of idea, it sort of finds similarities of the sort of the jaggedness of the mountain tops. It's also a drawing which may have inspired one of Tolkien's earliest drawings, only dating a couple of years later, known as Xanadu. So Xanadu may have been an inspiration. Look at that dome in the distance and the two lights on each side. 1913, domes of Valmar and perhaps the light of the two trees. That was the Xanadu for the John Garth and I don't agree about what is the real origin and source of the legendarium. And I think we're probably both right. But certainly that's that date of 1913. Another view of Kirithungol. Look at the jaggedness. Cabane Bertol seen from below. Notice a peculiar rock tooth of it. Access to it via added stairs and even ladders. Cabane Bertol up there. Really intimidating, you know. How do you go up there? Notice here the back gate door from the Hobbit. We don't know if there's any connection. I just look at similarities and you know, you draw your own conclusions. I can't say yes or no, but certainly it could have been an inspiration. Here's the Cabane Bertol, and in the distance, what do you see? Over there, what's that? It's the Matterhorn. The black silhouette of the Matterhorn, some miles in the distance. From the Cabane Bertol, I remember the dazzling whiteness of the tumbled snow desert and the black horn of the Matterhorn some miles away. If you cross your eyes, you'll see the Matterhorn in stereo. And notice here the view that you have. You have an uninterrupted view from the Matterhorn here. There's an uninterrupted view. Whereas on the other side, you don't have such an uninterrupted view from where you would have seen it. The dazzling, I show it in the map here. Notice that there is no high cabin in line of view from the Zermatt area, let alone a tumble-down snow desert, which we have there. So, they spent some time there, and the various incidents that Tolkien refers to in his letters, not sent to Michael, you can refer to that. I don't have time to present it. And so now Arola is down, is about down here. Yes, it's down there. And they need to go back to Sion to catch the train to go back towards Lausanne and Valorbe and England. They could have gone straight back down the valley again, or they could have crossed here and gone across. Now, this reservoir wasn't there before. It's one of the largest in Switzerland. And it could have been, they could have crossed there and gone down what is known as the Val Vernance and seen some sites there. I didn't actually go there because it was not in the information. But you would have encountered that sort of views at the junction of the Val d'Hérens and the Val d'Hérens. These are known in French as cheminées de fées, fairy chimneys. And there's one on here. So the mountain pass, it could have been one of those many mountain paths that Tolkien would have seen. As you get towards Sion, the particular train, and notice the moraine-rich hills. Very, very particular to that area. I haven't seen them really anywhere else, or certainly to that height. In Aman, the elven city, Tirion, is built upon a hill in the middle of the Kalakiria, cleft of light. This is one of the earliest drawings of the ancestor of Tirion, Tolkien's Tanaqui in the Book of Ishness, the city that became Cor in Lost Tales and Tirion in the Silmarillion. And he's also the subject of the poem Cor in a City Long Lost and Dead. Sion, capital city of the valley. It looks like a landscape out of a film, a science fiction or fantasy film. It's a real place. It's the capital city of the valley canton. Another view, the flower of silver and gold, the fruit of gold, with Tanaqui in the distance, dated from the 1910s. And, of course, 1928, Gondolin and the Vale of Tumladev from the Christhorn. Gondolin is supposed to be a reflection of Elven Tirion over the sea. Note the steep hill in the middle, similar to Moraine Hills at Sion. I cleaned it up, I scanned it, I retouched it, so that it's more probably where you can see the most details on that particular drawing, which you would not necessarily see otherwise. That's Elven, so Gondolin. Notice here we also have valleys and moraines, and this is big ridge here, this is the view of Rivendell. Having seen all those drawings, I specialize in looking at Tolkien's art and studying. I've done that since the 80s. And you have different depictions and renderings of the same location. You have Rivendell, you have one in writing down into Rivendell. The house, notice here, the house is facing west. The Rivendell looking east. House facing west, not much of the view from the porch. Rivendell 3. Now, the house is now facing east with a better view from the porch. This is Elrond's house. Note how the tower is not part of the main building, hence its absence. Actually, it's always been a separate building, but it's hard to notice it because of the scale of the drawings. The refuge, so notice here the four different renderings. The refuge of Imladris, established 1697 of the Second Age. The word refuge is a word of French origin, which refers quite commonly to high mountain buildings offering shelter to travelers, as well as a place where people go for protection. So, when Imladris is known as a refuge, is the word used because it was built to house the refugees of Eregion, or because it fulfills the function of refuges in the Alps, such as those Tolkien encountered and must have said in several times. So this is a retouched drawing of the Elrond's house. How many of you saw Rivendell looking like that? At least a two-story building with chimneys at each corner, and the porch on the western side. Many Alpine refuges are built to a similar architecture, which is a sort of standard template for refuges funded by the state, the Confederation. Notice the similarity of Elrond's house architecture, which closely recalls these Alpine refuges and hospices, and the roof in particular. The number of buildings I've seen like that in postcards of the time is just strange. So, a refuge in more ways than one. What I would like to finish now with, if that's okay with you, how much time do I have left?
15 minutes.
Perfect. Yeah. is, if that's okay with you, would you like a short excursion into Nargothrond?
Please.
So... Oh, oops, I have a problem. I don't know. It's not on PowerPoint. How can I do? How can I show what's on my screen without going on? So thanks very much, Andy. In the meantime, some questions and comments. Voilà. Magician, wizard in residence. So, the one I want to have is here, is this one here. And I want it full screen so that it appears straight on there. You can need someone there anyway. So you press stop or pause, yeah. Thanks. Okay, questions and comments, please. I mean, if there are any. Yes? So.
Actually, I've got one comment.
Yes?
Could we send the idea to the BBC and get Julia Bradbury to do a scene?
Maybe, I mean, that's a possibility. Okay. It's not over. I mean, there's, you have, remind me your name.
Okay. Brendan.
No, yes, and the chap behind?
Dean.
Sorry? Dean, yes, Dean is another great walker and trekker, like Thomas. Here, Thomas and Dean, stand up, show yourself to the others. These are people who have been there.
Oh, yeah.
So Dean has done an extensive trek around the Lauterbrunnen area to retrace steps in the area of the to match the story in The Hobbit to the location in Rivendell, which seems quite persuasive. So if you want to ask him for more details, he will be there to give you those details. Is that the case?
Yeah.
Excellent. And Thomas has traveled. Thomas has done a lot of traveling and revisiting those various steps. So Thomas is German, and he managed to go from the Grimsel Pass to Brig in... 11 hours and 9 minutes for how many kilometers?
51.7.
Okay, he's currently the world record on Facebook
I'm
for that particular distance. But in actual fact, he walked and walked, but perhaps didn't pay all that much attention to the landscape.
But we walked
in all
the time.
Okay, it's slightly askew because the camera had slid. So let's.
You
missed. Can I go back into it?
You need to
look at
the screen.
Yes, I need to look at the screen. Oh, yes. Okay. I needed to start about halfway across. Because that's an 8 minute long. I wanted to start about here. I mean, this is Nargothrond. Enjoy. This is the real place. It seems to me as real as can be.
Sounds about right.
Yes, it's amazing. I mean, I couldn't find the words. Oh, it speaks for itself. I'm not going to say anything. This is Ulriken, and really interesting areas on the other side of that. Great opportunities for touring, you know, organize, prepare your holidays, bring back photos, let's fool them together. Look at that. I get tears in my eyes, help! It's so overwhelming! No. And at one point, I noticed that there's a road that branches to the left at the moment. And we're going to take that road. To jump ahead a bit. And that's all right, we're nearly there.
Much more powerful it must be walking up.
Oh, God.
Yes.
That's where I want to go. So I'm going to back up the car. It's really, really important because there's a bridge a bridge across the Rhone, across the Narog. And the old road that Tolkien would have taken is now taken up by an aerodrome. Because it's a military air. In actual fact, I wasn't supposed to be there. I'm a great transgressor. And even the sort of the way the Swiss are hiding things under mounds, I find significant. Now we're going to turn right and cross the river. Look what is there on the other side. Wow. It's not the Elven King's Gate, but it's a Swiss refuge with anti-nuclear protection and so on. So, you know, if there's a people that for me are very dwarvish or elvish, it's sort of very Swiss, they can't help digging into places. And there's a hangar, a hidden hangar for planes. Planes are held inside there. So it's a sort of a... What I found really interesting is that it's life imitating art. And I will leave it at that. At this end. I just had a few. Thanks very much. Can I have a round of applause for Andy, please? So, what I started that years ago, just to retrace Tolkien's steps without anything else, and gradually, no. Some places looked familiar. I've been there before. Well, and having seen Tolkien's drawings since I had access to Tolkien's art since the 80s at the Bodleian, but I wasn't allowed to talk about it. I mean, I saw those drawings and the Tanaqui and all the Book of Vishnu's drawings, and nobody else had seen them, and I wasn't even supposed to talk about it because the estate is quite protective. And then, you know, you visit these places and you recognize places. And then you think, yeah, Tolkien draws inspiration from wherever he is. He is in Warwick, he writes about Cortirion. He transmutes. He visits a place, he transmutes it. He visits a place, another place, and it becomes a house of a thousand chimneys. He visits another place and it becomes something else. He uses his senses, he memorizes them, and then he reuses them consciously or unconsciously, we don't know. However, there's one thing I'm absolutely certain by now, is that he must have had a sketchbook on his journey which has been lost. Or it might still exist, but it might have some private details which the family has kept. And what we have, because in the Book of Ishness, which will be the subject of another talk, perhaps for next year, if you look at the psychological drawings of Tolkien, there's the Book of Ishness, which is a book, and then there's another folder called Loose Sheets from the Book of Ishness. If it's loose sheets, they must have come from somewhere before. So we'll never know, but certainly, I mean, all those years later, granted he may have had an incredible photographic memory, which may be the case, or maybe he just had drawn sketches and reused them. But certainly that landscape that you saw is not, of course, just Nargothrond, because he then, when he has used it, he reuses his own material, a bit like a Baroque composer, people would reuse their own material in other pieces, and so he reuses Tol Sirion to become something else, and it becomes the he reuses the Narble Throne, and it becomes the Elven King, the Elven King's place, and so halls and so on. And we find that again and again. It's in his nature. He can't help it, and thank God he can't help it. Thank God he couldn't, because he's made us dream with all that, and he still does. And he keeps doing that for a long time. Thank you.